Okay, good afternoon. Welcome to our open forum on Aleppo and the conflict in Syria. First question, I'm assuming people in the back can hear us if we talk at this level?
Yes. Yeah.
Good. The United Nations Special Envoy for Syria has warned that between now and December, if we cannot find a solution, Aleppo will not be there anymore. Stefan de Mistura, speaking after a meeting with EU foreign ministers in Luxembourg yesterday, said that any type of discussion that ignores Aleppo would be something that history will judge us for. Mosul should not be confusing the priority of Aleppo, in other words. If the world is watching Aleppo now, Aleppo should not be forgotten. And last week, I was pleased to hear that the incoming UN Secretary General Antonio Guterres said that it's a moral obligation on all of us to stop the suffering of the Syrian people, and that he feels deep solidarity with the Syrian people, and what is happening to them breaks his heart. And of course, what is happening in Syria is heartbreaking. Yesterday, 20 members of one family were killed in a Russian airstrike. Checking the news today, just before this event, they're still pulling people out of the rubble. Approximately 500 civilians have been killed in Aleppo since September the 22nd, largely as a result of Russian and Syrian government air bombardment, while Iranian-backed militia lay siege to the city and the rest of the world looks away. These attacks on the civilian infrastructure of Aleppo are clear war crimes, but really that's nothing new if you're following the conflict in Syria. State-sanctioned war crimes have been a staple of this conflict since its inception in March 2011. Diplomacy is at a standstill. Recently, Russia vetoed a UN Security Council resolution. The foreign ministers of the relevant countries met this past weekend in Switzerland, and they agreed upon nothing. And of course, the question of Syria has become part of the US presidential election, and it will be one of the top foreign policy challenges of the next president. So we're here today to have an open forum on the topic. The format will be as follows. I want to show a few brief PowerPoint slides, two short video clips. Danny and I will have a conversation on the topic, then we'll turn it over to you for a broader question and answer and discussion session. So Tiffany, can you go to the next slide? That, of course, is that haunting image from Yarmouk refugee camp in Syria. Next slide. The two young Syrian boys who embody the horror of this conflict that you've all seen and, you know, have that same sort of image in our minds, that other images that sort of embody the horrors of past wars. The two young kids, Aylan Kurdi and Omran Dagnish, are ones that have been seen by everyone on this planet, seemingly. Next slide. And of course, that's just a brief overview of the refugee crisis. The crisis in Syria has produced the worst refugee crisis since World War II. Most of the population have been internally displaced, over 5 million in neighboring countries, and a small fraction have fled to Europe, and even an infinitesimal fraction have been allowed into this country. Now, we have two YouTube clips that I wanted to show. They're about 5 minutes in total, 6 minutes in total, and they set the mood and atmosphere for today's event. Could you get to the first one, Tiffany?
Tenderness from a father who must watch the slow wasting of his child's body. Yahya Eskif, aged 11, was wounded in an airstrike, his stomach ripped open. Yahya is trapped by the siege, a child starving because of the damage to his bowel and the absence of proper nutrition, and constantly wary of new bombing. Hospitals have come under sustained attack. With only basic facilities, doctors struggle. And 7-year-old Aboud Al-Zayed suffers. Good boy, we're almost finished, the doctor says.
ومع استمرار هالحالة والحصار وما نقدر نرسل الريف ممكن إذا تحركت الشظية تؤدي لشلل تام للأسف.
Abut is taken home. His grandmother wants to get him to Turkey. Listen to the sound of rockets landing before she speaks.
بس بعدين بقول له بده يروح على تركيا طريق مقطوع يعني كل ماله صار في خطر على حياته.
There's still an irrepressible longing for normality. Ahmed Fahan on the right is risking the walk to school with friends. The children are now taught in the basement, in the hope they might be safer from falling bombs. But really, nowhere in East Aleppo is safe. Ahmed knows this. He's already lost a close friend.
كنا نروح على المدرسة في الصبح يعدي علي يصرخ لي نروح نشتري لبعضنا كاسات سحلب ونروح على المدرسة إذا ما عنده هو قلم أنا أعيره إذا ما عندي أنا دفتر هو يعيرني كانت أيام حلوة كتير.
Aleppo's agony began 4 years ago. But it has escalated dramatically. The city's east is a claustrophobic hell from which there is now no escape. Before the latest encirclement, many fled, children losing their homes and country. We met some of them in Lebanon's Bekaa Valley.
How are they supported? The siege represents just the first encirclement, because even if they manage to escape Aleppo, the children face a new trap. Those who've crossed the mountains from Syria behind me and arrived here in Lebanon find themselves carrying the trauma of war in a world where they're hemmed in by poverty.
Widad Fardosi arrived from Aleppo 3 days ago, crossing the mountains by night on a mule with a severe heart condition and now exhausted. She's joined her grandchildren who arrived with her son 2.5 years ago. Marwa is a cousin. Her father was killed by a sniper in Aleppo. This is the paradox of memory. It offers comfort and pain. The old Aleppo family, where parents were strong, has been upended. Abdul Fattah cannot work because of injury. So his 14-year-old daughter, Batul, works in the fields all day, every day, to support the family. Cluster bombs, bunker busters, barrel bombs, phosphorus bombs. They've all been dropped here by the Syrian government and its Russian allies. 106 children have been killed in just over a week. The Kremlin says rebels are deliberately using populated areas and rejects claims Russia is carrying out war crimes.
We are taking, as I said, most strict precautions to make sure that we don't hit civilians by any chance. If this happens, well, we are very sorry, but we need to investigate each and every accusation.
I've never seen anything so blatant as these kinds of attacks upon children. Everybody knows that as long as this kind of attacks with these massive explosive weapons takes place, children will be killed. It cannot be denied that this will be the result, so these attacks should stop immediately.
There are enough treaties, laws, and promises to protect these children. The trouble is that nobody with power cares to obey or enforce them. That is the tragedy of the children of Aleppo.
Thank you.
last two slides. And that's a slide that gives you a sense of who's killing civilians in Syria by one of the most reputable human rights organizations, the Violation Documentation Center. There's very little dispute on that. Some Syrian human rights organizations put the number a bit higher. Human Rights Watch puts it a bit lower, but 90% is the agreed upon figure, and there's, you know, very little dispute on that among people who care about the actual credible human rights reports. And then the last image that will stay up as we speak. So Danny, you and I have both been involved in this conflict really since its inception almost. We've organized a conference here, we edited a book together, we've been involved in hosting speakers. The big question that I think is on everyone's mind is, what can be done about Syria? What should we do? What should the international community do about the carnage in Syria?
Well, first let me say that I'm sure I'm not alone in feeling it's very difficult to speak after seeing what we've just seen. And I had already seen those clips. But it doesn't matter. Every time I see stuff like that, I just feel rocked to my foundations. And I have a lot to say on this subject, as many of you know, but it's very difficult for me to bring myself to speak when you're confronted with the human horror of what's going on. Mm. Well, obviously this is the big question, right? Mm. What is to be done? It's a huge one. I was hoping that we would start actually with a slightly different question, so let's come back to that one. I want to start with that final slide that we showed about the civilian casualties in Syria.
Right.
And I think you might have actually, I'm not sure how well people could see that slide from the back of the room, for example. I think Nader slightly glossed over it. Is it clear to everyone? The slide showed from the Violations Documentation Center, and as Nader mentioned, every independent human rights body and investigative body in the world that's looked into this has come to a general consensus that somewhere between 85% and 95% of all civilian deaths, specifically, and I think that's significant to focus on civilian deaths, the overwhelming majority of civilian deaths in Syria are in fact the work of the Syrian government and its allies in Moscow. Now, why do I emphasize this particular point? Because the narrative, what we have now is we have a war of narratives over Syria, right? In governments around the world, in activist circles, in schools of international affairs like this one, there's a war of narratives. We saw Russia's foreign minister Lavrov provide his perspective, and of course the Russian position is essentially that they're fighting terrorists. This is a war on terror.
Right.
Well, I think it's important amidst this war of narratives to be very clear about the fact that the overwhelming majority of Syrian civilian deaths are caused by one side of the conflict and not the other. One of the messages, one of the arguments in this war of narratives is there's no good guys, okay? Yes, the Assad regime is brutal, but the opposition is brutal too. Some people go even further. Some people say, well, actually, yeah, the Assad regime is brutal, but it's preferable to the kinds of monsters who would take over if it were to fall, right? So what I think we need to remember when we talk about this is that in fact, through this 5+ years of conflict now, there are many, many complexities. There are many nefarious forces fighting both on the side of the Syrian government and against it. And we can talk about some of the details of that later. But there's one thing that should come into focus, very clear focus, that I think really sheds a lot of light on the nature of the conflict and the nature of the Syrian regime, which is that it has now killed somewhere in the range of 90% of the almost 500,000, half a million civilians who have died in this conflict. And this is a point that needs to be driven home again and again. Now, what I think can be done about the conflict, I mean, we've talked about this for years, has a lot to do with that fact. Yeah. It's about protecting civilians.
Yeah. So what strikes me in this conversation about there are no good guys and that this is a war against terrorism is the obvious fact that the biggest perpetrator of terror in Syria is not considered to be a terrorist organization. That's the Assad regime itself. We sort of assume that terrorism is only the action of militias but not of governments.
Right.
And so that's something that I think often skews the debate on, you know, terrorism and violence. And the second point that you mentioned is that people who say that there's no good guys and it doesn't really matter, we shouldn't get involved, are people who I think fundamentally really have a very low view of the value of human rights. Because if you cared about human rights and you cared about sort of preventing a human rights catastrophe from, it's already unfolded, from getting worse, you would, you know, pursue the obvious plan in terms of what should be done. Try and restrain, contain, roll back the one perpetrator of the vast majority of the human rights violations, the Syrian regime and its Russian and Iranian allies. That would, I think, seem to me as if that would be the first logical step if you had a human rights conception in your framing of this particular conflict.
Well, and let's also add one aspect to that, which is one of the narrative lines that we've heard for years now is that you have the Syrian government on the one side, and then you have all of these foreign jihadis, right, Islamic extremists, right, religious fundamentalists, and terrorists on the other. Okay, well, first of all, that is a gross mischaracterization and distortion of the reality on the ground that completely belies the history of the conflict. But let's just take for a second that idea about there being all of these foreign jihadis and Islamic extremists. This conveniently ignores the fact that the Assad regime itself actually now has a massive transnational flow of jihadi Shia fighters on its side, mostly managed by its number one regional ally, the Islamic Republic of Iran. Yeah. There are now, by some estimates, more Shia foreign jihadi fighters in Syria fighting on the side of the Assad regime than there are ISIS fighters. And those fighters come from where? Hezbollah from Lebanon, Iraqi Shia militias across the border, who are now doing massive heavy lifting in the fight.
Right.
Even Afghani and Pakistani Shia, who are there as essentially mercenaries on behalf of the Iranian state. There are Afghan fighters who are there being promised citizenship in Iran if they fight for the Shia jihad. And then, of course, you have the Iranian state itself with its Revolutionary Guards force and even some of its regular army fighters. All of these forces marshaled on the side of the Assad regime. So one of the narratives is, oh, the Assad regime is a secular nationalist republic fighting these Islamic militants and crazies. In fact, there are at least as many, if not more, Islamic militant fighters, jihadis of the Shia variety, fighting on the side of the Assad regime.
Okay, extend the conversation, broaden it to a point that you and I have some difference over, and it speaks to this question of what should be done. How would you respond to the argument that, look, if we get involved, we meaning the West, it's just going to make matters worse? There's a very sordid record of Western intervention in the Middle East going back at least 300 years. The legacy of the Iraq War, of Libya, hangs over this question. So how do you respond to that often heard argument that we hear in the broad popular culture that, look, if we get involved, an already horrific conflict could get much worse?
Well, I think this is why the book that we co-edited on this subject is titled The Syria Dilemma, because there is no obvious, simple solution to the Syrian conflict. I think there was possibly one in early to mid-2012, when there was no ISIS. Jabhat al-Nusra at that time was a very small and very new force on the scene. And let's just remember that the, because it's often forgotten in this war of narratives and in the 5.5 years of horror, that this conflict began very much as a popular democratic uprising, very much in the spirit of the Tunisian and Egyptian uprisings and the other revolts that were spreading across the Arab world. It's not an accident that the uprising in Syria began in March of 2011, almost exactly within weeks of the Tunisian and Egyptian uprisings. They were inspired by the same messages, the slogans of those nonviolent demonstrators on the streets of many Syrian cities were the same exact slogans as those of their Tunisian and Egyptian counterparts. Bread, freedom, dignity, social justice. They were demanding democratic rights. They weren't even originally demanding the downfall of the Assad regime. Now, that and it was totally nonviolent at that point and non-sectarian. And I emphasize this because I think a lot of people have literally forgotten that. They don't know that. I've talked to activists and people at film festivals and educated people who actually say, really? I didn't know that.
Yeah, good point, but let's get back to the theme of Western intervention will make it worse. We have limited
I am of the view that at this point in 2016, Western military intervention would not solve the Syrian conflict as such, but I do believe that there are very limited and circumscribed forms of military intervention that could at least stop some of the most atrocious crimes being committed.
Such as?
And protect civilians. So, for example, as we've argued in the New York Times, I believe that there should be military force to ensure the safe passage of humanitarian aid, food and medicine, into the besieged areas of the country where civilians are starving to death and dying of easily treatable and preventable diseases. There is absolutely no argument for why the Assad regime should be, or the Russians, should be allowed to prevent, block, shoot humanitarian convoys.
Well, the argument that would be against international law without a UN Security Council resolution. You can't do those things.
And let's just be clear. Why is there no UN Security Council resolution on those things? Yeah. Because the Russian veto, obviously. Yeah. So, you know, and this is a larger question that goes well beyond Syria, but the fact is there are things in the international arena that might not be technically legal according to international law, but which are justifiable, which are legitimate. So, for example, the Kosovo intervention, which I don't want to relitigate here, but let's just remember that the Kosovo intervention was technically illegal for the same exact reason. Russia would have vetoed it, and yet there was a group of countries that got together, in this case NATO, and decided that it had to happen. I would argue that it actually was, on balance, a good thing for the planet and certainly for the people of Kosovo that it happened. So, the fact that it's technically illegal is not a conversation stopper to me. But I do not believe that a Western military intervention to topple the Assad regime and create a new democratic Syria is even a remote possibility.
Okay, what about a no-fly zone? Hillary Clinton's on record as saying that she wants a no-fly zone. Many Syrian activists that we're in touch with, particularly the Syrian Solidarity Committee in London, have put out this very detailed map in terms of how a no-fly zone might work. What do you think of that particular option?
Yeah, for those who don't know, there's a very impressive organization in London called Syria Solidarity UK. And they do some of the most important organizing around solidarity with Syrian civilians, human rights activists, and besieged communities. And they pressure the UK government specifically on these issues. And this just came out. I haven't had a chance to read it closely.
Okay.
But one of the things that struck me is that they are distinguishing between a no-fly zone and what they call a no-bombing zone.
Right.
And from what I gather, you've probably read it more closely, from what I gather, what they're trying to do is, again, focus on these very specific crimes, the barrel bombs.
Right.
Okay, there's only one side in this conflict that has helicopters and air power that drops barrel bombs. And let's be very clear about this. These barrel bombs are dropped exclusively on civilian residential buildings. They are dropped in areas with large concentrations of civilian Syrians. Now, so why is the why are the Russian and Syrian governments dropping these bombs? It's very clear. Amnesty International has made it clear that this is part of a deliberate strategy on the part of the Assad regime. And I find it striking, if people are familiar with the journalism of Patrick Coburn in London. Patrick Coburn is more or less, to make a long story short, a pro-Assad journalist. He is on the side of the Assad and Russian governments in this conflict. And even he acknowledged that the bombing of hospitals is actually part of a military strategy that the Assad regime deploys to depopulate areas. This has systematically been going on for several years now. There's a depopulation campaign. The idea is, if you bomb a hospital, right, when you kill a doctor, you don't just kill one person, you probably kill hundreds.
Right.
People leave areas, civilians leave areas where there's no medical care, where there's no food, where there's no way to get healing for your children, for yourself.
So a no-fly zone would theoretically, if implemented properly, stop that from happening. So the question remains on the table. Where do you stand on the proposed no-fly zone?
Well, I think it's a complex matter. I am not an expert in military operations.
So you're saying you're agnostic on the question?
No, I'm saying that I need to study it a lot more closely. I will say this. Okay. I will say that a no-fly zone at this point is a much trickier proposition than it would have been before the Russians got heavily and directly militarily involved in the fall, 1 year ago, in the fall of 2015.
Right.
And that's not something that should be written off lightly.
Right.
This is what John Mearsheimer calls the tragedy of great power politics, right? The fact that the Russians, we have absolutely a military confrontation with a major nuclear world power has to be avoided.
Right.
That is not something that should be sneezed off.
How many Syrians, though, have to die to avoid that option?
Well, this is why it's called the tragedy of great power politics. I mean, how many people would die if there was a nuclear confrontation with Russia?
Right.
These are the kinds of things. Now, maybe it is avoidable.
Yeah.
There's actually, I remember, there's a talking point
there is.
In this.
That speaks to that point.
That speaks to the point about, it's not inconceivable that this could be done. Now, I am of the view also, quite frankly, that the Assad regime is a chicken shit regime in the sense that whenever it is threatened with military action, it immediately backs off.
Right.
So, and the only time that's ever happened actually is August of 2013.
Yeah.
Late August, early September 2013, when the Assad regime used chemical weapons, sarin gas, against the residents of East Ghouta in the suburbs of Damascus and killed how many people?
Well, according to the US intelligence, about 1,500.
So the Obama administration briefly threatened to, probably disingenuously, we can now say in retrospect, but it briefly threatened to launch a retaliatory strike to defend this so-called red line against the use of chemical weapons, right? It never happened, but the Assad regime scrambled very quickly to hand over the chemical weapons, which it claimed it never had, to the Russians,
right?
So what that showed is that I believe that the threat of military force against the Assad regime could actually, with you might not actually have to use military force. I think that it is terrified of outside military intervention against it.
You're a man of the left, and the question of leftist opposition to the, any potential intervention to support the Syrian revolution has been a point of contention that you and I and a few of our friends have debated extensively. So just last week, the head of the British Labour Party, Jeremy Corbyn, released a statement, and I'd like to get your reaction on it. He said that focusing on Russian bombing in Syria diverts attention away from the atrocities by the US-led coalition in the country.
Well, I think that's an...
What do you think?
I think that's a reversal, a distortion, a turning upside down of the reality in Syria.
In
the
what
fact,
way?
Well, and the fact that the you saw the statistics, 90% of the civilians who have died in this conflict have died at the hands of the Assad regime and the Russian government. There's only one side in this conflict that has air power. It's the Syrian government and the Russian government. The United States is not inflicting one tiny fraction of the carnage, the war crimes, the atrocities that the in Syria that the Russians and the Syrians are. This is what I would say, this is just symptomatic. It's one thing to just dismantle it factually, that's easy. I think that that way of looking at things is symptomatic of a deeper pathology that many so-called anti-imperialists in the West suffer from, which is that that form of anti-imperialism ends up paradoxically becoming a form of imperialism. This is viewing the Syrian conflict through the prism of the United States and, in his case, the British, right? So it's all about the West. It's all about the United States, okay? Now that works very well when you apply it to some of the defining conflicts of the last half century, Vietnam, El Salvador, Guatemala, Iraq, Afghanistan. But if you try to make sense of the Syrian conflict through a purely American prism or Western prism, you get a badly distorted picture. And what I would argue is that this is actually a form of imperialism. It's all about us. It's not about the Syrian people. It's not about the desire of millions of Syrians to escape the 41 years of a torture state. Okay? That doesn't exist. The desires and aspirations of the Syrian people lost in translation, not in the equation. It's all about the West and stopping the United States. If that's your way of thinking of things, not only does that totally throw things upside down and create a distorting mirror, but it's actually a form of imperialism in which it's actually about us. That's an anti-imperialist form of imperialism.
Right. Okay, so one last question before we turn it over to the audience.
No, we want to know what you think, since you seem to be saying he shouldn't be thinking what he's thinking.
I'm happy to give you my view, and then we'll turn it over to the audience, and other things will emerge. My own view is that solving the internal intricacies of the political conflict in Syria is a much taller order than saving civilians from being decimated as they are in Aleppo. I think a no-fly zone, properly executed, could save lives immediately if the Syrian Air Force under Assad and the Russian Air Force can be intimidated to stop their bombing campaigns. And that would necessitate trying to balance the playing field, so to speak, by threatening the use of force, by sending a clear message to Assad, which should have happened a long time ago, that if he continues on in this reckless way, there will be immediate military consequences for his aircraft and for his Ministry of Defense if he continues to bomb civilians, and that the world is not going to simply stand by and watch Aleppo be decimated. I think that's what needs to happen. Now, who's going to take the lead, whether Russia is going to up the ante, whether this could lead to a global conflict? I mean, those are risks that we have to take. But I think what really disgusts me as I watch what's happening is that the immediate moment when we're watching these atrocities happen in Aleppo, and they've been happening for 5 years, American, British, French, and many other aircraft are flying over the skies in the same airspace. And they have an arrangement with Russia and with Assad not to interfere with their bombing raids. And so that raises the question of, you know, complicity, not direct, but indirect complicity. There are things that we can be doing that would have an immediate effect in my reading of the conflict that would save human lives. Now, we can't solve the eternal conflict. That requires negotiations. But at least we could save human lives by grounding the Syrian Air Force, taking out their runways, and sending a message to Putin in particular and to Iran's supreme leader that it's not going to be business as usual anymore. They can't carry on in this rapacious way. There will be consequences.
What's the likelihood of that happening in the Clinton administration?
Well, that's a good question. What we know is that Hillary Clinton, and we talked about this yesterday, actually has taken somewhat of a risky position when she said at the last presidential debate that she favors a no-fly zone and the creation of some sort of safe zone. And the reason why it's a risky position, because any intervention in the Middle East post-Iraq is not something that's going to win you votes. The fact that she actually said that suggests, and from my own reading of the conflict, she's deeply committed to it. Now, people on the left say, aha, this is exactly what scares us. This is the hawkish, interventionary, neocon worldview that has gotten us into this problem to begin with. So that's the debate. But I don't think that there can be any alleviating of the massive humanitarian and human rights crisis in Syria today unless someone is willing to stand up to Putin and Iran's supreme leader Khamenei and their junior stooge Bashar al-Assad. Unless someone is willing to sort of say that, look, we're not gonna look away anymore. There will be consequences if you carry on, military consequences. And if you read the plan that the Syrian Solidarity Committee have laid out in terms of no-fly zone, they're pretty good in terms of how you deal with potential Russian opposition. So let's open the floor to the rest of the audience and hear what you think about this issue, what you think should be done, should not be done, I mean, there is an opinion out there. Last time we had this conversation upstairs in the context of the legacy of the Obama administration, and then we carried it over into my class. Some people were saying, look, you know, as tragic as Syria is, we just can't intervene and we shouldn't intervene. Because we would make it a lot worse.
Michael?
Okay, you want to take
Suzanne?
Yeah.
Michael, I said...
Yeah. Please. You take the questions.
This is a Christian, and it goes well back in the conflict. This is not a question of any immediacy, but what did we think was going to happen? The Russians were more or less invited in to tamp down ISIS.
Supposedly, to tap down. If you look at where the Russian bombs have actually landed, very few have ever attacked ISIS.
Right, but that was in theory the plan.
Right.
Had someone not read the 40 years of history that Russia has in Syria? I mean, there's Latakia, and had a huge base. The Russians have always had an interest, even back when it was pre-Russia, the Soviet Union. With Syria. So, did we not grasp this phenomenon?
I'm not sure what the question is.
Sounds like more of a comment.
I guess the question is, was it not clear by inviting the Russians in that we would get into this sort of position in the first place?
When the Syrian government invited the Russians in other words, yeah. Well, this is what makes the Syrian conflict so bloody, complex, if not intractable, is the fact that there are several wars going on in Syria.
Right.
Unlike, let's say, a case like Kosovo that I mentioned earlier, the Russians technically weren't going to go along with an intervention, but they didn't do anything to stop it. They didn't have a strong interest in Kosovo. And many other examples. There are examples where interventions have worked. Sierra Leone, Cote d'Ivoire, East Timor. There's a list, right? One of the things that made those interventions possible was the fact that you didn't have great power rivalries or regional rivalries. In the case of Syria, you have a geopolitical rivalry with the United States on one side, Russia on the other. You have a regional rivalry with Iran and Hezbollah on one side, and the Saudis and Qataris and Emiratis and Turks on the other. So you have multiple levels. This is like a three-dimensional chess game in which any kind of action of the sort that we've been talking about for the last few minutes, it's not necessarily made impossible, but it's made enormously more difficult and delicate by the fact that Russia is deeply invested in the survival of the Assad regime.
You want to take the questions?
Oh yeah, there was a Suzanne.
So I'm not necessarily opposed to the no-fly zone idea. I'm kind of with you, Danny. I'd sort of need to understand the details better. But in general, I think we need to understand that a no-fly zone is a military action. And to your point, Nader, that politically solving the conflict within Syria is so complicated. I mean, I think that people tend to write off a little bit too easily the possibility of reaching some political accommodation on the broad outlines of a solution in Syria. And we have to recognize that while this has been very informative, and persuasive to me, your presentation about how the Syrian regime is really the big bad guy in terms of harming civilians, but in terms of the political conflict, the U.S. and the West are not objective, right? We're not nonpartisan. Syria's been an enemy of Israel for a long time. I mean, it's kind of like the orientation towards Gaddafi. The U.S., the West has disliked the Assad regime for a long time. And so I think that at the core, if you got the major international players on the same page about the overall scope of a political solution in Syria, they could exert pressure on their clients within the country. And if we listen to the diplomatic news and what John Kerry has said and others in the State Department, they've come pretty close. Like, Russia isn't really that much of a fan of what's going on. I think they're stuck in it. to some extent, and I think Iran similarly. Mm-hmm. I don't think they're quite as 100%, you know, willing to stick it out with Assad no matter what, as it might appear.
Yeah.
I think the and I'm saying also that to reach this accommodation, the U.S. and the West might have to bend, and the Saudis and all of them might have to bend a bit too, in terms of allowing Assad to stay for some transitional period of time during some transition to a more democratic process of some kind. So I think that, yes, we should look at a no-fly zone and military backup, military threats, you know, to back up diplomacy. But I think that a core focus should remain on diplomacy. Yeah. I don't think it's hopeless.
Well, see, there's an update on what you just said. There has been a broad framework for trying to get to a negotiated political settlement of the internal conflict. And it was embodied in UN Security Council Resolution 2245 that was passed about a year ago in December 2015. And it's basically what you hinted at. It's this idea that there needs to be a political transition in Syria. When Assad leaves, is subject to some, you know, debate at the beginning, at the end. The Syrian opposition obviously want him to leave at the beginning. The Russians and the Iranians don't want him to leave at all, but the actual framework of the Security Council resolution says there has to be a political transition, implying that Assad has to go.
And those have been the Geneva principles.
They come out of the Geneva principles.
But the principles are partisan. The Geneva principles back from when Mokhtar Brahimi was working on it and others, those were the West. That did not include Russia. That did not include Iran.
It did. Because Russia affirmed and voted in favor of the UN Security Council Resolution 2245, which embodies the Geneva Principles. That's the broad consensus on this organization called the Syrian sort of working group of countries that includes Iran, includes Russia. Now, the problem is every time you get to the negotiating table and they go to Geneva, the negotiations break down because the Syrian government position is we're not going anywhere. And they have backing from Iran and from Russia. And the Syrian opposition come to the negotiating table and say, we want to implement the terms of this, and we want to talk about the details. And so the negotiations break up, and there's been several rounds of negotiations, and they all end in a stalemate because, in my reading of it, on the ground, the parties, primarily the Assad regime, backed by Russia and Iran, feel that they can advance their position and get a better negotiating position by changing the battlefield calculations. And that's, I think, exactly what's going on with respect to Aleppo. The plan is that if they can overrun Aleppo, when Hillary Clinton comes into power and there's another round of negotiations, Assad, Iran, and Russia will be in a very stronger bargaining position because they'll have more territory, and they can say that, look, you know, maybe a political transition doesn't need to take the form that the Syrian opposition want. So there's been a long backstory here of things that are happening, and it fundamentally comes down to, in my view, not the good intentions of the parties at the negotiating table, but the balance of forces on the ground in Syria. You know, without a change in the balance of forces that can challenge the Russian, Iranian, and Assad position, there's no incentive for them to negotiate anything. And you know, Obama, when he had to react to the Russian intervention, predicted that Russia is going to get bogged down in a quagmire. They're going to get stuck. I think projecting his own fears in many ways. Mm-hmm. But my reading of what's happening is that Putin has played his cards very, very carefully. He's not bogged down at all. He's running the show. He's asserting himself.
It's actually been a cost-free, almost cost-free
intervention
for Russia.
There's been very few Russian casualties, and they're in the driver's seat. And I think until someone is willing to challenge the Russian position primarily, there's not going to be any change in the diplomatic stalemate or in the prospects of a negotiated settlement. You want to handle the questions?
I broadly agree with that answer with a few amendments that I don't have time to get into. Yes, sir.
Since I've been coming to these forums and listening to the conversations, I've learned that the French had their planes loaded at the time that President Obama said that he's going to make a decision about what to do with Assad. Isn't that correct? I mean that conversation came up in one of these forums, and somebody, one of the ambassadors, said that the French had their planes loaded.
Well, I think you're basically right. The French have been much more interested in getting involved militarily to deal with the problem, but they're not going to go by themselves. They want to follow an American lead. So whether they had the planes loaded or they had some other plan in mind, I think you're basically correct in the point that you're making.
So I have two kind of questions. Number one is perhaps now that we didn't do anything, which in my mind I think we should have back then, but that's a different. But perhaps that's the reason why none of the Europeans would want to get involved, because if the United States aren't going to get involved, they're not going to get involved. And in my second part of my question is the result of not doing anything, isn't that worse than what would have happened had we done something to begin with?
Well, that's a good point. That's the issue that was raised when we had the forum upstairs at the beginning of the quarter with respect to the legacy of the Obama administration. We often hear rightly that there are costs to intervention. And if we get involved, we don't know where this is going to go. But there's another side to that debate. There's also costs to non-intervention. And we're seeing them right now in Aleppo. We're seeing them with the humanitarian catastrophe. We're seeing it precisely, and this is what's often forgotten in the conversation. I think it's pretty clear to me that it's exactly and precisely because of the failure of the international community to deal with the internal conflict in Syria much earlier that we have an ISIS crisis. There was no ISIS in 2011, in 2012. ISIS was basically a dead organization in Iraq when American troops were pulling out. But it's because of the mayhem and the chaos that was unleashed as a result of the conflict in Syria, largely at the behest of the Assad regime, that a vacuum was created and that they moved over the border and eventually established themselves as the most formidable, organization that was laying claim to that piece of territory.
Which it no longer is, by the way.
Well, no. Well,
not in Syria.
Well, it's obviously a weakened force.
ISIS
now
has been marginalized. Yeah. Actually, one of the healthy things, despite all of the horrors that we've been talking about today, one of the healthiest developments in the last few months of the Syrian conflict is that nobody really talks about ISIS anymore because they've become largely irrelevant to the conflict.
Well, Russia's talking about it.
But the American
position right now, Obama's position is that we are in Syria, our planes are flying over there to deal with ISIS.
That is correct.
That's the official position of the United States. We don't care about the internal conflict in Syria. We can't do anything about it. Aleppo can go to hell, we're bombing ISIS.
That is essentially the Obama administration's position. Right. But we have the facts to show that the Russian intervention in Syria has virtually nothing to do with ISIS.
Right.
The numbers are there.
Right.
The Russian bombs do not fall on ISIS-held territory. Yeah. Very, very tiny percentage.
Yeah.
The majority of Russian bombs fall on civilians and on specifically in territory held by Jabhat al-Nusra, Jaish al-Islam, and other Islamist groups.
Lewis.
I want to hear Lewis on this, yes. Yeah. I noticed your hand go up at a very specific moment, Lewis.
You guys are very humble about your military knowledge, so I'll be unhumble about
Thank
mine.
You.
I am a military policy expert.
Yes, you are.
So let me answer three factual questions that have come up that, Danny, you politely deferred to, and I know you know you're being very nice. Number one, to your point about whether the Obama administration's initial set of airstrikes regarding the red line were real or not, they were very much real, and I can verify that through personal information.
But why did he kick it to Congress then? That's my question.
Because he felt that the chemical weapons were the number one, were the larger priority, and he felt that deal would work, and he was incorrect.
That's important to point out. The deal never happened.
The initial threat was not only very real, it was also indicated and signaled very effectively to the Syrians and the Russians. They did all the things that you do to indicate to someone that bases, we were in bases locally, we were EM signatures were turned on, the whole drill was run. The strikes were not taking place. I can also just, as an aside, verify this gentleman is direct. The French at numerous occasions have offered fully ready to go capabilities if the United States would provide the necessary EM support, EW support, radar support, etc. Which gets me to my no-fly zone point. Again, without, I generally agree with you gentlemen on this issue, so I'm just going to add facts if I can. The tricky part about the Syrian no-fly zone that separates it from all other no-fly zones during most of our lifetimes is that most no-fly zones involve not only airplane suppression, but surface-to-air missile suppression. And the thing we don't talk about enough, and in some of the literature you cited doesn't talk about enough in my opinion, is that what we did in northern and southern Iraq was not only did we keep planes down, we degraded massively surface-to-air defenses.
Right.
On a routine basis, we flew over them, they turned on their radar, we used it as an excuse to eliminate those threats. The complexity, which we told them we would do, so let's not let the Iraqis off the hook, it wasn't an act of barbarism. We said, if you turn the radar on, it's going away. We were dealing with one adversary in a fairly wide set of airspace. The Turkey-Russia shoot-down.
Yep.
The Israeli, Lebanon, Syrian SAMS networks. The Russian deployment of potentially a deployment of triple-digit SAMS. The reason you hear an air force like the United States or the NATO air forces balking at this idea unless they get a very broad carte blanche, or what we call ROE, is that there's a whole bunch of things they're going to have to do to keep from being sitting ducks should the Russians and the Syrians change their minds. And these are, as someone mentioned, going to be very military activities.
It's a declaration of war, is it not?
No, it is not. Yeah. But it involves far more than simply telling the Syrians, don't take your helicopters off the pads. It will involve surface-to-air defense issues that will make it a much broader initial set of strikes or activities than simply an air-to-air agreement, which is why we haven't done it.
Here's that's helpful.
Lastly,
that's helpful.
Lastly, this is my last factual point. Danny, I'm afraid your plan won't work.
Which plan?
Which is, if you simply put troops on the ground to protect the refugees, to some degree a la Somalia, the record on humanitarian intervention is quite clear. The people who want to shoot at you are the winners, the people who are winning, because they're not creating a humanitarian crisis out of neglect or barbarism. Mm-hmm.
That's my point. This is strategy.
Right. But if you put Americans or NATO forces on the ground, it is in the Syrian regime's benefit to meet those folks with a serious, with significant, they'll blame it on militias, they'll come up with ways to not do it with Syrian uniformed troops. But there will be Americans killed. How many, I don't know, but here's what the Syrian government's counting on. How many was it in Somalia?
Very few.
It's a low threshold, is the concern. I'm not even opposed to the policy as much as,
no, it's
again,
a good point.
It's not as going to be clean as we're only here to protect the refugees. By definition, what the Syrians are doing is intentional.
Right.
I'm done.
I think that's those are all extremely helpful and illuminating points, and we thank you for that, Lewis. Losing track of hands here, but I see a very enthusiastic one up.
Yeah.
Can you put up with another GAYS intervention?
Sure.
Suzanne is the junior GAYS.
Aha!
Yes. But, Nader, with all due respect, I would like to argue against your position.
Sure.
But it's not because I want you to agree with me that intervention is futile and counterproductive, but for my reasoning of why I get there. Yeah. By the way, folks, I'm a Muslim, American, Egyptian, but I lived a long time in my boyhood in Syria. I learned to drive my car over there, and I had my first bicycle in Aleppo.
Wow.
And these children could have been my grandchildren. But it's difficult to maintain critical thought under these circumstances. I'll try. My point is very straightforward, and it comes from the experience of American intervention and Western intervention over the decades. I won't go over them, it takes time. The point is, you intervene in the Middle East with the Arab and Islamic sensitivities, you become the enemy. It doesn't matter who else is against you. Everybody coalesces. The Arabic proverb is, translated into English. Me and my brother against my cousin. Me and my cousin against a stranger. Guess who is the stranger? Who is the stranger? We have no dog in the Shia Sunni conflict. We have no way of dealing with internal Syrian problems. I lived through the early era of military rule in Syria, I remember it very well. And I know for sure, irrespective of which military strategy you use, you become the enemy, and everybody coalesces against you. Therefore, these casualties, these civilian casualties, will only escalate. Thank you for listening to me.
Thank you. Okay.
Thank you very much for sharing that.
Do you want to comment on that?
Briefly.
Yeah.
Thank you for sharing those powerful thoughts and your experience growing up in the region. I agree with the general sentiment that you've just expressed. There are deep historical roots to those feelings. I will say, however, that millions of Syrians today, Arab, Muslim Syrians today, are extremely angry with the international community and with the world for not stopping the Assad regime's killing machine. Not for intervening, but for not intervening. That's a fact. There are many, many testimonies to this. Syria is not Iraq. It's not the same. The legacy of Iraq, the shadow of Iraq, looms over Syria. No question about it. And you can't just ignore it. I think Iraq is the reason that there was never an intervention in Syria. Obama has more or less said so. I think that the Syrian people tragically are paying the price for the Iraq war, a war that should never have happened, that was illegal, criminal, sold with lies. The Syrian intervention that never really took place, ironically, was the exact opposite. The very first chapter in our book, The Syria Dilemma, is titled, Syria is not Iraq. That's very important. And the second point I'll just make is that I do not believe that the Syrian conflict is about Shia versus Sunni. I think that is not what is actually going on.
I think that's what he said.
Well, he said that the West cannot solve the Sunni-Shia conflict, which I agree with. Yeah. But I don't think the Syrian conflict is about Sunni versus Shia. I think it's about conflicting images, visions, values for what kind of society people want to live in. That's why I always evoke those first 8 months of the conflict, the uprising from March 2011 until the end of 2011. The slogans were not about Shia, Sunni, Islam, or any of that. It was about democracy, dignity, and human rights.
And we lived through the failed Egyptian revolution version 2.0.
Right. A different story, but yes, related. A different story, but there are many parallels, but also some significant differences. Yeah. Yes. Mubarak went away. Assad never would. And there are reasons for that. Rafael.
First, to thank you, express deep gratitude for having events such as this, to praise you for your initiative and to be very, very specific and strategic. First, if that map's correct, why Aleppo? I mean, ultimately, it looks blue there, which is mostly blue surrounded by government forces. So why this is almost like a symbolic effort along with the strategic lines you were defining. So that's one, a simple question. And secondly, perhaps more importantly, moving forward, how can we have your narrative, which to me I'm absolutely persuaded by, that we need to be making vocally 24 hours every day, that this is ultimately about 90% of the casualties being conducted by the Syrian government. How can we have this narrative become more known out from this room? And I, of course, this is an important initiative, but how can we go beyond these walls and make this better known?
It's a great question.
You answered your first question. Symbolically, Aleppo is the second largest city in Syria. If they conquer it, that's a big step forward for the Assad war machine in claiming that they can reconquer the rest of the country. So that's the objective. In terms of
it's actually it's the second city because Damascus is the capital, but it's actually has the larger population.
Yeah.
And it's the commercial capital.
Yeah.
It was. Now, we have to say, speak in the past tense. Yeah. Aleppo was the commercial capital of Syria. It's been decimated, as we've seen. It's also one of the great sites of world civilization.
Culture,
there are more UNESCO World Heritage sites in the city of Aleppo than in possibly any other city on planet Earth, and they've been destroyed.
In terms of your second point, which in many ways is the much more important one, is how do we channel the moral outrage that we feel about this conflict and the huge civilian catastrophe that's been going on for 5 years, and now we're all watching it again. How can we take it outside of this room? I was deeply shaped by my own thinking about this issue, this conflict, was deeply shaped by an experience that I had about 20 years ago in the context of Bosnia. And I remember specifically during the course of the first 3 years of the war in Bosnia, which was a genocide, the international community, including the United States, did not want to use the G word.
Genocide.
And the Clinton administration went out of its way to not use that word because they knew if anyone invoked the word officially, it would lead to a huge debate about, well, if it's genocide, then we have a moral obligation to stop it. And so just like Obama is doing today, claiming that this conflict is rooted in ancient sectarian differences, that's an exact quote, that date back a millennia. 20 years ago, Bill Clinton said the exact same thing in the context of Bosnia. These are ancient ethnic hatreds and that go back, he said, not 500 years, sometimes 1,000 years. We don't know what we can do about it. Better just leave it alone. And they were very wary, government officials, of having a conversation such as the one that we're having here, highlighting the civilian horrors that are taking place, because they know if there's global public outrage, and we've seen it over the last month, in terms of what's happening in Aleppo, governments have to respond. People are protesting. There was a debate in the British Parliament last week. There's a lot of agitation. What are we doing? Now it's part of the US national presidential debate. Because people, thanks to social media, put pressure and affect the global civil society debate. Governments who are pursuing their own national interests, as they define them, don't want to get involved in conflicts that have a pure human rights component to it, unless they can justify it in terms of some sort of larger national strategic objective. So I think what needs to be done, and drawing on lessons from 20 years ago, is that people need to get organized. If you really feel passionate about this issue, you have to name and shame our government officials. You have to ask the obvious questions. What are American aircraft doing flying over Syrian airspace today and turning a blind eye to the bombing of Aleppo? Don't we have a moral obligation? We have aircraft, we have, you know, assets that are there, but we don't want to use them to ameliorate the human rights catastrophe. So organizing, mobilizing, I mean, Danny and I are part of this whole network of Syrian activists that are sort of been working on this for many years. But I think, you know, fundamentally realizing that we can't change public opinion entirely, we certainly can't influence government policy, but at least in democratic societies, to the extent that we have a democracy left in this country, you know, people have a voice. You can organize, you can mobilize. I mean, it would be great, for example, if at maybe the next presidential debate, if someone were to stand up and publicly sort of raise this issue in a forceful way. What can the international community be doing? What should the United States be doing that could perhaps at least lower the death count? So these are the things that I think can be happening, that should be happening. They made a huge difference, I would argue, in 20 years ago in the context of Bosnia, because of the reporting, because CNN had a camera crew in downtown Sarajevo, they were reporting. Every time there was an attack, it would become, you know, it was similar to Vietnam, you know, people were shamed, governments were embarrassed. And then you had Srebrenica, and then there was a clear threat to Western interests, and then they intervened. But of course, by then, most of the deaths and the genocide had taken place, but at least it halted the killing.
And I would just add to that, that on a more local level, at the bare minimum, we should be demanding that the United States take in more Syrian refugees. It's such a disgrace.
Yeah.
How few refugees the United States has taken in. It's like that's the least that we could do, given that we're not doing anything to alleviate the humanitarian catastrophe inside Syria. Look at how many, you know, people forget about this because we always focused on the, when Aylan Kurdi washed up on the shores of Europe, people talked about the European refugee crisis. Guess what? The majority of Syrian refugees are in the immediate neighborhood of Lebanon, Jordan, and Turkey. The overwhelming millions of them living in refugee camps in those three countries. Very few refugees. Germany has taken in quite a few. Sweden has taken in quite a few. There are more in Europe than in the United States, but it's a disgrace, frankly, that we have taken in so few, and we should demand that these lies that Trump and like-minded people talk about the threat of Syrian refugees, there is zero evidence for what they're talking about. The facts suggest the exact opposite. And there's an incredibly stringent vetting process for anybody coming into this country. Yeah. Barbara.
You talked at the beginning of your talk about conflicting narratives. And with a view to your last comments, I would just like to ask the narrative that I've heard for a long time that Obama sold Syria to the Iranians for the sake of the nuclear deal.
Yeah.
Do you have any comments?
I wouldn't agree with that framing, but I think you're on to an important point. We now know that when Obama was threatening to launch airstrikes after the use of chemical weapons in the summer of 2013, that the United States and Iran were in secret negotiations on the nuclear agreement. And it's been reported subsequent then that had Obama, I think this is one reason among many why he didn't strike, is because it would have complicated the nuclear negotiations, and that was the prize, that was the focus, that was the priority in his foreign policy for the Middle East, getting to a nuclear agreement with Iran. He prioritized it. It's an agreement that actually I support, but of course, the consequences of that is, I think, it narrowed the prospects and the options that he had to deal with Syria. So that's, I think, actually what happened. He realized that, look, you know, you gotta make your choices, and if we go after So now that the accord has been signed and it's being implemented, the argument no longer holds. There are still things that I think President Obama can be doing and should be doing, but of course he's on his way out. And he's stated a position that, look, you know, he's not going to get involved. He's not going to risk his legacy on trying to sort of get involved in the Syrian conflict.
But I think Barbara's question speaks to a larger narrative out there, especially among some of our Syrian friends.
Yeah.
The idea, the feeling, the sense, yeah, the perception is the United States is now on the side of Iran in the Middle East. Yeah. It has switched sides. And it's on Iran's side. It's making, it's normalizing its relations with Iran, mm-hmm, and it's selling Syrians up the river. And I think that's wrong. I don't think that the United States has switched sides onto the Iranian side geopolitically. I think it specifically wanted, yeah, this nuclear deal, which I also support. Yeah. But I do understand why many of my Syrian friends do not support it. They felt that it was a gift to the Iranians somehow. That's, yeah, not what the plan, that's not what the nuclear deal was. But there is a perception amongst many Syrians that somehow, and it's certainly a perception, by the way, if you want to talk about a big platform, Saudi Arabia has been absolutely ballistic about this point, that the United States is now on the side of the Iranians and it's taken the Shia side and the Sunni Shia battle and so on and so forth. That is just utter nonsense, mm-hmm, and propaganda. The United States is actually doing, is complicit, speaking about being complicit in war crimes, Saudi Arabia is bombing Yemen to smithereens right now, killing children, bombing hospitals, committing war crimes, atrocities, crimes against humanity with American-made weapons, okay? And the United States is probably doing less about that because Washington is so afraid that we had to do something to, yeah, placate the Saudis because they were so upset about the Iran nuclear deal. So let's just shut up about the Saudi war crimes in Yemen. It's a disgrace.
Yeah.
But I think you're setting Obama short. Obama, in my view, was very conscious of the point I made earlier, that you get in there, whether it's in the air or on the ground, that's a distinction with no difference. And you're in a quagmire, and you can only make things worse, and civilian casualties only increase in the history of American intervention, yeah, starting from Korea,
yeah,
and Vietnam, on and on and on, proves that point.
Yeah.
That there, well, you are right.
Yeah.
No, you are right that is Obama's thinking.
Yeah.
That,
yeah,
we it's pretty, yeah, clear if you read Dexter Filkins' investigation in The New Yorker about 2 years ago, where he went inside, yeah, Obama's Syrian brain trust and showed that Obama had kind of surrounded himself, his Syria policy desk, he surrounded himself with people with completely opposing views on Syria. So he had the sort of realists on one side, like Chuck Hagel and Dempsey, who were very skeptical and cautious about getting involved with Syria. He had Samantha Power and Susan Rice on the other side, who were much more humanitarian interventionist leaning, and they basically canceled each other out. But there's no question that the center of gravity of Obama's stance toward the Middle East,
yeah,
is one of caution. Nader likes to talk, yeah, about the Batman
analogy yeah,
that Obama invoked, yeah, in his interview with Jeffrey Goldberg.
Yeah, I mean, Obama's view is that the Middle East is just a basket case, and that it's
Gotham City.
It's beyond hope, beyond repair. And he used the analogy in his interview in The Atlantic that it's similar to the 2008 Batman movie, I think it was called The Dark Knight, where you have all these warlords that control a certain turf, but then you have this Joker who comes and tries to set the entire city on fire, the Joker being ISIS. And he says, we have an interest in trying to sort of, you know, stop the Joker from, but we don't want to get involved in this, you know, in this Gotham City.
This swamp.
Yeah. But let me just speak to one issue. I'm deeply sympathetic to your criticism of U.S. intervention historically. I mean, all of us who come from the Middle East are raised and know the sordid legacy of U.S. foreign policy toward the region. But realize the consequences of what you're suggesting are that Putin, Khamenei, and Assad run the show in Syria, decimate Aleppo, and the 500,000 people that have already been killed will increase in number. That's the predictable consequences of an absolute no intervention whatsoever by the United States anywhere in the Syrian conflict. And that's a calculation that I think I don't agree with. I'm sympathetic to those people who invoke the legacy, but I think it's fundamentally a question for the Syrian people to decide on, because it's their future.
Yes, in the back. Yeah. Someone who hasn't been called on yet. Yes, please.
So we've been discussing this conflict and why the U.S. is not involved from kind of the situation internally within Syria. Can you give your perspectives on this idea that we're not involved because of the lack of, or not being interested in having a proxy war conflict with Russia and kind of the greater geopolitical implications that could have?
Yeah. Very quickly, that has become, I think, a concern of recent. But right from the beginning of the war in Syria, there was an open discussion and debate in the Obama administration as to what should be done about Syria and whether Syria actually matters. And there was a calculation and a debate that took place. And if you want to, go read the New York Times, September the 26th, 2013, where National Security Advisor at the time, Susan Rice, basically made the argument that, look, we had an internal review in the United States, and we came to the conclusion that what happens in Syria is just not part of our vital national interests. So it could be a humanitarian catastrophe, they acknowledge that, but getting involved, risking anything, would be beyond what the assessment of the Obama administration is. And so, of course, the calculation back then in 2013, this was right after the proposed airstrikes, after the gassing in East Ghouta, the calculation was that what happens in Syria will stay in Syria. But of course, looking back, we can see that that's one of the biggest miscalculations of the Obama administration, because not only did the conflict not stay in Syria, it destabilized the entire region, led to sectarian war, led to a massive refugee crisis that has led to the rise of right-wing parties, and I can make an argument that's connected to Brexit. But also, and precisely, the absence of dealing with the internal conflict in Syria led directly and precisely to the rise of ISIS, which has now become a reason why President Obama has been forced to re-engage, although in a very limited way, trying to really deal with the symptoms of the problem and not with the root causes.
Yes?
Just one more. Nader, don't you think that in Obama's thought process, that if we go in and we do something in Syria, what the hell's the result? Who takes over?
Well, exactly.
I can take this one.
Take that one.
I'm glad you asked that, because my own view for some time now has been that there is no military solution to the Syrian conflict itself. And here's why. Let's say, hypothetically, but the Assad regime were toppled today or tomorrow. It's not likely to be, but let's just play this out as a thought experiment. The Assad regime is toppled. What happens? Does democracy come to Syria tomorrow? Of course not. What you have now, this is why it matters to go back to 2012. Had the Assad regime fallen in late 2011 to mid-2012, which it looked like it might, by the way, and let's remember, the Assad regime is not invincible. Yeah. The Assad regime was very, very wobbly for a while there, which is why the Iranians and Hezbollah and Russia got involved, why there's this massive transnational Shia jihadi flow into Syria on the side of the Assad regime. But that was then, this is now. At this point, you do have so many factions, such a proliferation of rebel groups, opposition formations, many of whom are at odds with one another. You have ISIS, you have Nusra, which has now renamed itself, which is really just a marketing scheme. You have literally hundreds of rebel groups. And what would happen if the Assad regime were toppled tomorrow is that those groups would be at war with each other for years.
But that raises the bigger question, that it's not simply sufficient. It's necessary but not sufficient to call for the toppling of the Assad regime. Because unless you have a plan for the day after, the situation could get much worse. So that's why any comprehensive and serious attempt to deal with the crisis in Syria has to deal with a plan for stabilization, reconstruction, transitional justice, et cetera. And the dilemma here is that who in the international community is going to step up and agree to send troops to provide the security, the stabilization, to provide the resources to rebuild the economy? That's a huge order. 20 years ago, we could have done it, and we did do it in the case of Bosnia. This is the big difference in Bosnia. We sent in troops, we grounded, you know, we pushed...
Not just we, but NATO,
and
NATO, the West.
Everyone did, and we invested, and we kept NATO troops there for decades. In the case of Syria, who in the international community, who among the regional countries has the ability, the interest in doing so? And so that's why
the conflict is so tragic
and so complex. But of course, it's also complex if you just let it bleed. because what's often forgotten is that in the bombing of Aleppo, how many ISIS recruits are being created every single day when young people are sitting there and saying, look, you have American aircraft flying over, you have all these claims about human rights and decency and values that the West proclaims it stands for, but no one's doing anything about our misery. And so if you're a young kid in Aleppo or in any of these besieged cities, it's perfectly rational that at some point you're going to start to think, well, maybe all of this talk about human rights, rule of law, democracy, civilization really doesn't matter. Maybe the ISIS narrative that completely rejects that worldview and says we'll create an alternative reality, maybe given our misery, that's a realistic option.
Peter, actually two Peters, both, yes, please.
So quickly, so let's think yeah. the opposite. So nothing happens. Aleppo is starved out, bombed yeah. out, everyone dies. The another million, so just say another 500,000 yeah. people are killed. Another million people escape, emigrate out of the country. The country is decimated. What does Assad have left?
And yeah.
And then, of course, he will not be a safe player at right. that point in time either.
Yeah.
So what is that long-range view yeah. if nothing happens?
Well, I think Assad's calculation is to simply carry on to survive and be the last fighting force. And then, you know, what happens next, who knows? But as long as there's no opposition on the ground, maybe someday he can reconstitute the country and then pass it on to his son.
We'll have no country left.
Right. Right, there'll be no country left. And so if you look at actually the statistics that have come out, I mean, there is no state anymore.
Right.
The figures for what it would cost to rebuild Syria today are in the trillions of dollars.
That's if the war ended today, which it's not
today.
Going to.
So, but, right. this raises the bigger issue for the international community. Well, what's the plan? Is the plan simply to just let... I mean, so we're going to crush ISIS, let's say, within the next 2 years. But as long as there's this vacuum, I can guarantee you, given the same social, political, and theological conditions that exist, there's going to be another iteration of ISIS that's going to take advantage, and then we'll be back to square one again. So unless you have a plan, which is why I think this claim that you sometimes hear, you don't hear it anymore, but remember about 2 years ago people were saying, look, you know, Assad's a son of a bitch, but given all the options, he's better than the alternative. Maybe we could just try and reconstitute and rehabilitate him. The problem with that is to think that the person who's primarily responsible for this mayhem can be a source for stability in a population that is, you know, 70% Sunni and that's widely resented among many people in the region. It's just wishful thinking.
Well, it's
going to be a delaying point for another tragedy just down the road.
Which has led some commentators to suggest that maybe there is no Syria anymore. Yeah. Maybe there's a partition of the country. Yeah. Maybe there are two yeah. or three or four Syrias.
Yeah,
Joshua Landis,
anything?
Most famously, yeah. Yeah. has proposed this. Yeah. Now, I mean, I have not yeah. ever met a single Syrian who agrees with that,
yeah.
by the way.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
But it's the kind of thing, this is where historians yeah. come in handy, right? I mean, it just raises some interesting questions that I don't think there are obvious answers to. What is Syria? Why are the borders of Syria drawn in the particular way that they yeah. are? We are now exactly 100 years, okay? In 2016, we are 100 years yeah. since two European yeah. diplomats named Sykes and Picot yeah. at the end of World yeah. War I sat in a room together yeah. and drew up the borders yeah. of what is now the modern Arab state yeah. system.
But here's what you miss in that debate on Sykes-Picot and the colonial borders. It doesn't matter where the borders are. It fundamentally matters what happens inside those borders.
Obviously, but maybe those two things are connected.
Well, how are they connected?
Because the Assad regime, if you look at yeah. the political sociology of the Assad regime, this is a mafia state
right.
that was constructed by one family. It was constructed in this imperial aftermath, in the ruins of the Ottoman Empire. And the French basically said, look, yeah. we need these minorities
yeah.
in Lebanon, we need the
to
Christians.
Bidding, yeah.
In Syria, we need the Alawis.
Yeah.
You have a situation where the Assad family engineered a state that is very much coup-proof. The idea was to make it coup-proof. Yeah. How do you make it coup-proof? You get loyalists
yeah.
deep inside the military yeah. and the security apparatus. You have this is why the Alawis, who are about, yeah. what, 8, 12. 9, 12% yeah. of the population, they're about 80%. Of the upper echelon yeah. of the senior yeah. leadership yeah. of the military and yeah. security forces. Now, that's not
an
accident.
That speaks to my point. It's about how the actual internal arrangements of a country are organized, whether it's based on some sort of sense of the rule of law or the rule of a mafia state. It doesn't matter where the borders are. We can redraw the borders of Syria, but if it's the same type of, let's say, Assad mafia state, how does that help it? It perpetuates the problem.
I agree, but it raises questions. The gentleman mentioned Egypt before. Yeah. Why is it that in Tunisia and Egypt, yeah. when millions of people took to the streets and demanded the departure yeah. of their dictators, the tyrants who oppressed and tortured yeah. them, why did those two gentlemen actually just basically take off?
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
with a little yeah.
but
tug
that had
of
nothing,
war.
That had nothing to do with borders. That had everything to do with the nature and the unique arrangement between civilian and military relations
Correct.
In the country, and the nature of the authoritarian system. But where in Syria, it's very different.
It's
than
very
it was.
Different. Yeah. And this, but a lot of the reason that Syria yeah. is different, I think, is precisely because yeah. of Sykes-Picot. Yeah. Because what you have in Syria is an arguably, yeah. I don't have a dogmatic position yeah. on this, but many historians and analysts are coming yeah. to the conclusion that the nature of the Syrian state yeah. is such yeah. that Joshua Landis, for yeah. example, who I disagree with on many issues, he's right about this. The Assad clan has created a cult of loyalty.
Right.
That state is packed with nothing yeah. but loyalists. That's yeah. all it's based
yeah.
on.
Yeah.
People who are willing yeah. to kill
yeah.
and, if necessary, die to preserve this mafia.
Yeah, no, you're right on that.
And
that's why he says that, you know, this claim that we hear now in the debate that we want to preserve the Syrian state institutions.
Right.
We don't want them to fall. The nature of the state is such that if you pluck the king off the throne, the entire state collapses because he has all his cronies
Precisely.
Who are loyal to him, not to the state.
That was kind of yeah. a wickedly genius yeah. move to construct
yeah.
the state in such a way that only yeah. you and your family
yeah.
can run it.
Yeah.
But now we
yeah.
might have a self-fulfilling prophecy,
yeah.
right? The Syrian uprising
yeah.
was all about, no,
yeah.
we actually can have a democratic,
yeah.
pluralistic society.
Yeah. Yeah.
But maybe you can't
yeah.
in
okay.
Syria today.
Let's take two more questions, then we have to end it. One, and then two.
When you started earlier today, was showing slides of the refugees. Reminded me of the days I used to work in Beirut, when they had the wars there and complete destruction. And you can't really get a good feeling unless you've seen the destruction and how these people suffer over there. And my feeling is that once whatever solution is going to take place in Syria, with the groups that are in there now, they may try to go down to Israel and take over Israel.
Who specifically are you talking about, Peter?
The groups that are supporting Assad.
Well, I mean, they might want to do that, but Israel is the fourth or fifth largest military power in the world. They wouldn't stand a chance. They may want to do that, but they wouldn't stand much of a chance. So last question here.
I guess I'd like to, and I appreciate being last, I'd like to point out what happened in this conversation.
Hmm.
We started off in awe, in disgust over the human rights crisis, and an idea that, gee, anything that we could do to solve that would probably be worth doing. I mean, that's certainly what
yeah.
that does to you.
Yeah.
But as the conversation went along, we got into this impossibility of
right.
solving the problem
yeah.
there. And here we are at the end. Maybe needed to be reminded that we started off with something where
mm-hmm.
maybe there is a solution
mm-hmm.
into something in which there's no solution
mm-hmm.
at all.
Right.
So I guess I'd like to ask.
Yeah.
Get us back on point.
Yeah, okay.
Just for a moment.
Okay, so I in terms of what the international community could be doing or should be doing, I distinguish between the human rights crisis, what's happening in Aleppo, the bombing and starving of civilians, and the internal political arrangements that could lead to it. So in terms of the first one, I think the creation of a no-fly zone, a no-safe zone, properly constructed, could decrease the number of dead bodies that we're seeing. I strongly support that. I think the plan that our colleagues in England have laid out provides a good blueprint. That's much easier to do. It has risks, but I think the risks of not doing that are much greater.
Maybe not easier,
and,
but possible.
Yeah, and
yes.
I think it's also connected to the possibility of a political settlement. The political settlement is not going to come about unless there is a change in the battlefield conditions and a balance of power.
Absolutely.
Right now, Russia, Iran, and Assad are riding very high and confident because there's no one seriously to challenge them. And I think it's a disaster both in the short term and in the long term if we allow that position to prevail. Strictly from a human rights perspective. I'm not saying anything about U.S. national interests.
Great.
So I think if you can start to send a signal to these, the international power, Russia and Iran, the major regional power, that if they want to have their interests secure in this part of the world, then they're going to have to compromise. They're not going to be able to carry on in this chaotic way. There's going to be consequences if they do. I think if you start doing that, the no-fly zone, the human rights component, then perhaps the other component, the political arrangements, the negotiations, will start to be perhaps easier to come about. But, you know, it's not going to happen by itself. And up until now, President Obama has taken the position that, look, we have no national interest there. Why get involved? Whether the next president will make a calculation, a reassessment of it, she's on record that she is, but whether she has a plan or not, beyond what she's already stated, we don't know. And we'll just have to wait and find out.
I guess my point is, there's some possibility of forming a coalition in this country, maybe in the West, about the civil rights disaster.
Well, yeah,
there's
no chance
of forming a coalition with a solution to the geopolitical situation.
Well, but there is, as I said to Suzanne's question earlier, there has been somewhat of a narrowing of the gap in terms of what a political settlement is. There is a UN Security Council resolution, there have been negotiations, there's a broad framework that has been in place, and we've had negotiations.
Yep.
They haven't gotten anywhere, largely because I would argue that Putin and Khamenei and Assad calculate that they can still advance their bargaining position by changing the battlefield conditions on the ground. So there's no incentive, and we have no leverage.
Here's my only difference with Nader's position, is I think there's a little slippage here between intervention to protect civilians on the one hand, and intervention to change the battlefield conditions to increase the leverage of the Syrian opposition when it comes time to negotiating a political settlement for the future of Syria. Those are two very different things.
Right. Yeah.
Now, they could be related.
Right.
Yeah. I am of the view that even a minor, very circumscribed humanitarian military intervention of the sort we've advocated to get food into starving, besieged areas, to starving civilians in Syria, or the grounding of helicopters so that they can't drop barrel bombs on residential buildings, that might actually change the facts on the ground. But as a question of arguing for intervention, you have to be very clear. Are you intervening to help the Syrian opposition at the negotiating table a year from now, or are you intervening to stop civilians from being slaughtered? Yeah. And here's my final point, and I hate to end on a pessimistic note, but let's face it, we're talking about one of the darkest, most horrific conflicts of our lifetime, if not the most. The facts on the ground in Syria today, the battlefield facts, are not pretty, okay? And I don't think that a Western intervention, at this point, a Western intervention to help the Syrian opposition is a very tricky proposition, and here's why, okay? I'm going to quote an interview with somebody whose work I draw on heavily, Charles Lister. For those who don't know, Charles Lister he's the author of the definitive study of Islamist groups in Syria. It's called The Syrian Jihad. He's also a senior consultant to the Sheikh Group's Track 2 Syria initiative. For those who don't follow these things, that is, in that role, Charles Lister helped coordinate a two-year process of engagement with the leaderships of over 100 Syrian armed opposition groups, okay? In other words, Charles Lister is deeply sympathetic to the cause of the Syrian revolution. Here's what he himself said, quote, "The Nusra Front has pursued a smart long-term strategy focused on embedding itself into the revolution and into opposition societies. In this way, it has built itself a protection blanket that the Islamic State never had." In other words, ISIS was always viewed by the vast majority of Syrians as a foreign entity with a completely unappealing agenda, not Nusra Front. "Due to its continued determination to fight the regime and the relative restraint of its Sharia enforcement compared to the Islamic State, the Nusra Front is still largely accepted by opposition forces as a legitimate part of the opposition." And here's the rub. "My take," says Lister, "is that the Nusra Front is a wolf in sheep's clothing. Syrians should wake up to see who they are allowing to develop within their midst. Eventually, it will be too late, if it isn't already."
So on that pessimistic note, let me do two things. First of all, thank you all for coming. But I also want to speak somewhat personally now, and I'm sad to announce that my colleague Danny Postel will be leaving us. He built this center with me starting 4 years ago when I plucked him from Chicago, but his ties to Chicago have pulled him back, and he's leaving. He's going back to Chicago where he'll be taking on a new position very similar to this one at Northwestern University. So, Danny, your contributions to our center, to the intellectual life of our school, have been enormous. You will be missed. I'm hoping that perhaps circumstances will work in our favor, where at some point you may be able to come back. But until you do, know that you will be missed, and that your value, particularly to our center and to me as a colleague, is very difficult to measure. So please join me in thanking Danny Postel.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.